So let's start the best paper candidates session. First paper is Sea of Lights, Practical Device-to-Device Security Bootstrapping in the Dark, presented by Flor Álvarez. Before handing over, I would just like to introduce the first speaker a little bit. Flor, she received her diploma degree in electrical engineering and information networks from National Polytechnic University in Ecuador back in 2007, and her master's degree in information technology from Hochschule Mannheim in 2011. Since 2014, she is working at TU Darmstadt, focusing on mobile and infrastructure-less wireless networks for emergency response communications, with a particular focus on authentication and availability. So please join me in welcoming Flor Álvarez.
I have already one. Yes. Thanks for the introduction, and welcome to this presentation. I'm going to present Sea of Lights, a decentralized authentication and key management solution for a security bootstrapping in the dark. This is joint work with Mats Cohagen and Matthias Holly for the TU Darmstadt. Let us revisit today's conventional communication infrastructure. It is centered around a rich set of applications such as social media, emails, etc., which build on internet and are commonly designed in a centralized fashion. And of course, scale billions of users. By now, mobile users using the smartphones dominate the internet usage. These smartphones can support hundreds of applications, which heavily rely on third-party provider to offer some security features. However, authentication and thus trust and key management relate on the availability of such infrastructures. But what happened if this central infrastructure or this service got completely dark due, for example, natural or man-made disasters? In 2017, in the span of a few of weeks, the Caribbean was devastated by three hurricanes. These disasters affected mainly the communication and information capability of the population by damaging the infrastructure, making the communication system unavailable, or by knocking out the power. Furthermore, this central infrastructure can be also affected by the censorship. This picture here showed the protest in Hong Kong in 2014, also called the Umbrella Revolution. This revolution was not televised, but the people can still broadcast information by building a mesh network. In these scenarios, a device-to-device communication can be an option to enable the population to communicate without relying on the central infrastructure. But, however, in absence of this central infrastructure, the users are left without a practical solution to bootstrap security on their device. Because, as mentioned, the security features are designed in a centralized fashion. Well, let's start with the problem. The idea of this infrastructure-less communication is not really new. It has been investigated and developed over the past 20 years. The idea was to facilitate the creation of this infrastructure without a fixed infrastructure. But this security device-to-device bootstrapping is still a problem. Existing works focus on security focus mainly of the security, providing a security routing protocol, or they try to improve the fairness of the use under the network, but also they try to increase the robustness by detecting corrupt nodes. However, trust and key management based on in this strong assumption that there is still a communication to a central infrastructure, or there is a pure trust relationship between all devices. Of course, there exists also a solution based on the web trust paradigm. However, these solutions are inefficient. Most of them had a complex implementation, required educated users. Furthermore, they have also relied on strong assumptions. And I think one most important thing is they don't use a secure hardware module to provide a strong key management solution. Even though mobile phones feature a hardware security module, this is a smart card. the end user is typically not able to utilize the security keys storage to for head arm purpose. Let's start with our work. Sea of Light is a practical device-to-device security bootstrapping to the dark and solution. The name is inspired by silent protests, such as these candlelight vigils, with the light is spread among the candles of a large group of people, effectively forming this sea of lights. But what it is? This is a lightweight scheme based on a simplified version of the Web of Trust paradigm. We implement a modular solution that is, we support hardware and software way key storage solution. That means we use secure elements to provide a security mechanism for this key storage. The main research challenges of our work can be explained as follows. Okay, the first question was how to provide credentials on demand, this authentication on demand, but also how to manage trust directly while securely storing keys. In the next 20 minutes, I will present our work. I will start with assumptions, that is our security and system model. After that, I will present our concept, that is our decentralized authentication of the key management consent. After that, I will explain the technical implementation of our architecture, how we can integrate our solution in a third-party application. And at the end, I would show the results of our evaluation. Let us start with assumptions. The system model, we consider users owning a device capable to establish this device-to-device communication, for example, by using Wi-Fi direct, Bluetooth, etc. Each device has also a mechanism to discover another device in its proximity. It can be by sending a hello packet, or in our case, by sending a fingerprint. Of course, there does not exist a prior trust relationship between the device or security associations, and the central infrastructure is not enabled. Regarding to the security consideration, an adversary can act as passive or active, as also insider. The adversary can intercept, fabricate, or destroy the message, but she cannot break the cryptographic primitives. The main goal of our solution is to provide a security bootstrapping, that is authentication, trust, and key management service. We define the main goals of this adversary, try to destroy the service. Let's start with our concept. Okay, as I mentioned before, we implement and simplify a version of the Web of Trust paradigm. As we note, in a decentralized networks, we cannot rely on these central institutions to provide authentication to other users, that is, we need to establish this direct trust. That can do it by, for example, trusting another user by ourselves. This can do it by using direct contact between the users. But we need also an additional channel for this security or authentication. The Web of Trust paradigm introduced also this implicit transitive trust concept, that is, we do not necessarily need to meet another user in person to establish a security connection. For that, if user A trusts user B, which in turn trusts user C, B can serve as a trusted introducer for establish a trust between A and C. Similar to another Web of Trust paradigm solution, trust in our solution is determined by trust level and the degree. But in contrast, for example, to the PGP, we don't assign manually trust level for each user. In our solution, the trust level will be assigned automatically using these following roles. It can be ultimate for the owner of a key, can be trusted for the direct trust relations, where an object signed by you is considered as trusted. Can be also known for transitive relations, second degree and further, where an object signed by T is considered known. And the degree defined if a transitive relation is still considered known or not. Well, we implement this is a decentralized authentication using two protocols. The first one is the handshake protocol. which cover this bootstrapping and establishment of direct trust or mutual trust. First, each device can generate a public private key, issue a certificate, and if this device are in the proximity, they exchange this information. After this data exchange, they need to verify this information. For that, they need a secure channel. Without loss of generality, we implement three methods. The first, a QR code scanning method, an NFC-based method, and a visual comparison. Since comparing all bytes from a public key can be tedious and error-prone, we introduce or we use a short representation of the public key. This is the fingerprint, that's the hash value of the public key. After this verification is successful, the user issues a certificate for this information and they exchange this information. Once this trust relation has been bootstrapped, the users can collect information from this transitive relation. For that, we implement the synchronization protocol. Well, we have the two device with information I mentioned before, but they can also collect additional certificates over the time. In this case, we have a device, they have two known users, and he asks for a question for a specific user to another device, and another device responds with this information. And finally, this information we will merge in the local repository of the device. We have also a key management concern. This key management is responsible for the management and protection of an authentication key, permit use and key extraction. We consider two groups of key, an initial authentication key, which only aims to achieve authentication and trust between the devices. That's the only reason for this initial authentication key. But we have also subkeys. The idea of the subkeys is to provide additional security features such as confidentiality. These subkeys are generated by a third-party application and authenticated with our initial authentication key. As mentioned before, we support, our solution is a modular solution. We support hardware and software-based storage mechanism. It depends of the which of these methods are supported by the device. For example, for the software-based solution, we support a trusted execution environment-based storage, in our case, under key storage. Only to remember the idea of this trust execution environment, your CPUs have two virtual environments, a non-secure environment and a secure environment. The non-secure environment loads and executes the normal operating system, for example, in our case, Android, and this secure work. In the case of Android Key Store, there is a trust application which is responsible for loading and using all cryptographic keys stored on-site on it. We also support hardware-based solutions, for example, an NFC-based token. This hardware can be considered as sealed container for these cryptographic keys. The access to these keys are actually using this NFC communication API provided by Android. Note that irrespective of which method we use, we need some PIN or password or an additional unlock mechanism to access to this key storage. Well, we have already explained the assumptions, our concept. I'm going to explain yet the technical implementation, the architecture and integration, and at the end, I will show the results of our evaluation. Well, SOL is an Android service encapsulated inside on a standalone application that runs in its own process. Our architecture is a two-layer architecture. We have our service here. The first layer is the trust management layer. The main task of this layer is to manage this trust repository relations between the device. It includes the management of this trust repository and the controlling of data of this repository, for example, public keys, certificates, etc. This layer is also responsible for the key verification method. As mentioned before, we support three methods, but it can be also extended. And furthermore, this layer also performs the two protocols that I mentioned before, that is the handshake and the synchronization protocol. The key management layer is responsible for the initialization of our initial authentication key, and also the support of all operation with this key is used or is involved. For example, to sign some key or to issue some certificate. We implement this layer two modules. The first one is the hardware key storage module. This is the basis for all hardware-based solutions, as all these solutions employ a similar protocol based on certain application protocol data you need commands to communicate with these Java card apples. We have of the software key storage solution. For now, we support two software-based key storage, the Bouncy Castle for versions, for Android versions four or before. For versions from 4.5, we use Android key storage. This layer also provides an interface for specific functions to the trust management layer. The integration, we provide a proxy library that allows another apps to use our service in direct fashion. To clarify this use, let us assume the next scenario. Let be application with a chat app that wants to provide some security communication between devices in a decentralized fashion. For doing so, it creates a subkey pair and use our library to register this library in our service. Hence, our service signs a key and issues a certificate and stores this information in our local trust repository. And we take care of these handshakes and synchronizations protocol. And of course, the exchange of data is responsible for the application well. It implies that multiple apps running in a smartphone neither need to build nor to maintain our trust repository. Well, I have already explained our concept, how we implement our solution, how we can integrate this solution in RT party application. I would like to start now with our evaluation of the results of this evaluation. The goal of our evaluation was to investigate the performance and scalability of our solution, as well as its feasibility on real device. First, we investigate the performance and scalability aspects of the task management part by means of simulation using the opportunistic network environment one. For the simulation, we analyzed two metrics, the propagation of trust and the memory consumption. Additional results, please refer to our paper. Second, we demonstrate and test our implementation on real device to show its feasibility, but also to test the computational performance of the key management. Here we focus on the selection of proper cryptographic algorithms and how they differ in efficiency and performance. Well, let us start with the propagation of trust. First, a simulation runs 12 hours. We considered 120 devices, and degree was selected from 1 to 3. As we see, while implicit relations, maybe we cannot see really very well. While implicit relations increase exponentially, the direct trust indicates linear property. Well, that is because the direct relations doesn't depend for an algorithm or for the degree. This depends on the probability of performing a handshake between the device. As we see, we also show the results for RSA and ECDSA cryptographic algorithm. We can also summarize, okay, both of them had a similar trend, with ECDSA being a bit slower than RSA. Now I present the results of memory consumption for a 3G network. Each device starts with a maximum of 3 subkeys, also that's a random number from 0 to 3. The size of each subkey was 4K. We plot also the two selected cryptographic algorithms, RSA and ETDSA. This experiment examined the overall memory consumption of persistent storing the trust repository. This includes public keys, signatures, subkeys, and subkey signatures. As we see, the memory consumption is directly influenced by the selected cryptographic algorithm. We can also see that the number of collecting signatures of known device increase with each neighbor encounter. The storage space in the repository is mainly occupied by signatures. We can also confide some findings of previous experiments, namely ECDSA requires significantly less resources than RSA, but the consumption is still moderate. Well, regarding to our real-world measurement, we test the computational performance of the key management on real device, even though there is already a lot of research focus on this performance of the optimization of cryptographic algorithms, we still conduct our own experiments. The evaluation covers both cryptographic algorithms that we support and also hardware and software-based solutions. We repeat the experiment 50 times, and each iteration takes as follows. Also, for the key generation, we generate two key pairs, KP1 and KP2. KP1 is considered valid, that is, all certificates or signatures issued by KP1 are considered valid. For signing, KP1 issued 1,000 signatures, and KP2 issued 200 signatures. And the end, for the verification, KP1 verifies all signatures. For the hardware weights, key storage, we use a smartphone, we use Nexus 5, and an NFC token. And for the software-based solution, we also use a laptop. This slide shows the performance comparison of both key storage mechanism. While ECDSA has better performance regarding issued signatures, RSA is more efficient for verifying signatures. The performance of NFC is not measured for verification, as only operations regarding to the private key are carried out on it. We also see that the performance of the hardware-based solution is poor, but because the processor embedded on this NFC token is relatively slow. Notwithstanding, this result depends literally on the capabilities in terms of cryptographic operations supported by the device. For example, if a token has a dedicated coprocessor for these operations, it will be faster compared with another that used the regular coprocessor. That is the solution. We demonstrate that the employee solution are feasible on investigate mobile platforms. We are going to the conclusion and summary of our presentation, where we implement a practical device-to-device security bootstrapping in the dark. That is like with a scheme based on the simplified version of the Web of Trust paradigm. Our solution is a modular solution that supports hardware and software-based key storage management. We provide a library to integrate our solution with a third-party application. And the focus of our system is for local and urban environments, for example, emergency scenarios. The work in progress, we are currently working on more performance improvements, for example, the optimization of the WAN-WI use or memory consumption, etc. We plan also to use data from large scale field tests that we conducted. That's what, over one day, we collect information for 120 devices that connected directly in an ad hoc communication mode. Thank you very much, and happy for any questions.
So we thank Flor for this excellent presentation, and I open up for a few questions. Hands up. Yes, Fabian.
Okay, as far as I see, you looked at RSA and ECDSA for the cryptography for the certificates.
Yeah.
As one of your use cases is using such a system for messaging, things like forward secrecy are very important here. And both of those are really not quite suitable for that. And that raises my question. Did you consider something like, for example, double ratcheting or other more modern protocols for key exchange, which provide better properties for forward secrecy and other, more more security features? Yeah.
Well, we test really on implementation with these two cryptographic algorithms. As mentioned before, we implement a modular solution. That means if the Android device also supports these additional or new cryptographic algorithms, you can also implement this in our solution. I hope I answered your question, for at least.
You're satisfied. Good. Yeah, we have room for one or two more questions. I will hand over the microphone. Nils?
So one of your requirements, and also in comparison to the Web of Trust, was a better usability, right? Have you also tried to evaluate the usability within your performance evaluation?
Sorry, could you repeat the question?
So one of your requirements was that you want to have a good usability, right, for the end users?
Yes.
Right? And you also said that the usability of the Web of Trust is not good enough.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So, but in your performance evaluation, usability was not an issue at all.
Yes, you are right. Do you mean we have not really results about the usability of our solution, right? You are right. We have only a small test bed for our solution. We have tested our solution on our group. But that's the reason because we also plan to use this large data set from this smarter project. Because, okay, we have information from real device, and maybe with this information, more improvements, we can test also in our real scenario, for example, in a university or something like that.
Very good. One final question, two. We take George first. Yes.
Well, when I saw the situation with the mass crowds, many, many people there against some government or somewhere else, when I think about countries like this where this happens, there are probably a lot of bad guys in the crowd itself. So how do you know that your neighbor, if you can trust your neighbor even or something like this?
Well, the focus of work was not really a relational scale environment, as we are focused really in local environments. And we use this directly encounter between the device. That means you need, of course, some kind of trust to this person.
Mm-hmm.
You have this encounter and you decide, okay, I trust or I don't trust this person.
This is no technical problem, I know.
Good comment. So the final question will go to our general chair and can meanwhile ask the next speaker to proceed to the stage so we save some time. Kemal.
Yes, thank you very much. I wonder about your success metric. So I am assuming that you're showing that convergence at certain time, like how many people it will reach in a certain time. Is that the success metric that you use other than the energy and resource consumption? You were showing, not this one, but if you go back.
This one here?
Go back. I think the first one, number of relations in a certain amount of time. Is that your success metric? Like how do you understand that you're successful? Like it's how many people you reach in certain time? Is that the metric?
That was also the idea, also to test how does this propagation of trust, of this, they reach some saturation, we can say that, if you reach the total number of nodes that we consider. For example, we have 120 devices, and we say, okay, the first device is direct translation, and we have, at the end of our simulation, we have arranged all users on all network. Yes.
Okay, so in that case, why ECDSA is slightly lower Because I know that ECDSA is much faster than RSA.
Mm-hmm. I don't show here the results, but maybe for more information you can also see our paper, but we also see that we need more operations for verification, because you have also, you collect also always more signatures and you need to verify this information. As I mentioned before, the performance of ECDSA is not good for verifications operations. That's the reason, because he's a business lawyer.
Good. So by that, we thank Flor again for her excellent presentation.
Thank you.